Hi, Kathy, dietitian with Highland Primary Care in Airdrie, and I was asked to split the blood pressure and cholesterol essentials class into smaller segments. So that's what I've done. This is going to be the cholesterol, and then there'll be another part, which will be the blood pressure, a piece of it. They will work nicely together because definitely all the stuff we learn about the good fats, the fats we should choose in the cholesterol portion will apply to the blood pressure as well. I think they do work nicely together, but maybe just splitting it into shorter segments will make it more manageable and fit into your busy life. So what we'll talk about today just quickly is the benefits of a heart healthy diet. We'll talk about that cholesterol profile and what all those numbers mean, and hopefully help them make a little bit more sense. So if you have your numbers, if you want to pause and pull them out, that might be helpful. And we'll do the heart healthy diet, the four F's, and it's not what it sounds like. So we'll go into that, and then eating away from home, and then other lifestyle factors, so smoking and activity. So just wanted to let you know that the handouts for this class are all on our website, and the easiest way to get there is just to go to www.hpcn.ca. So it stands for Highland Primary Care Network, hpcn.ca, and then go under the tab that says Programs and Services, and you'll find a HIP, the Health Improvement Program. And if you click on that link and scroll down, there's a PDF document that says handout for HIP classes. You click on that, and then if you see blood pressure and cholesterol essentials, all the handouts that go along with these two segments will be there for you. So benefits of a heart healthy lifestyle, there are many, and we know that as up to 8 out of 10 incidences of premature early incidents of heart disease and stroke are caused by lifestyle factors. So we know that there's lots of things we can control. So things like what we put in our mouth and what we do for activity, and definitely our habits, things like smoking and alcohol consumption. If we have healthier habits, that really does lower our risk. So yeah, there are a lot of things we can't control. We can't control our family history, our age, our gender, our race. Of course, certain segments of the population have a little higher risk factors. If there's any pre-existing conditions like diabetes or liver disease or thyroid disease or metabolic syndrome. But there's lots of things we can control, and that's what we're going to focus on in this presentation, as we always like to focus on the things that we can control. So things like reduction of smoking, reduction or quitting of smoking, stress and sleep. I'm going to just talk about that super briefly, and then the biggest part of what we're going to talk about today is the dietary habits, but then we'll finish off a little bit with activity and just a mention of alcohol. So who should get checked? In a nutshell, just about everybody. If you're over 40 now, you should be screened every 2 years, get your lipid profile done. And then if you have any other concerns that are on this list, like heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, if your waist circumference is a little bigger, if you are a smoker or you have smoked, if you have erectile dysfunction, that's just a little yellow flag that we should be checking things out, or a family history of any kind of heart disease or stroke, you're probably going to be asked to be checked a little earlier if you're not quite 40 yet, or you might be checked more often. But everybody should be checked. It's good screening. So just a quick mention of stress, because it can be a factor and sometimes it's overlooked when we're talking about cholesterol and blood pressure. So our bodies and brains are amazing, but our brains are really wired quite up historically. We use a primitive part of our brain when it comes to stress. And so when we default to that part of the brain, what the brain wants to do is either get you out or help you fight something. And the idea that the brain is trying to get across is to mobilize fuel stores to your big muscles to help you fight or get out of there. So what it does is squeeze your blood vessels. So think water in a garden hose. When you squeeze it, the pressure goes up, right? And so that's what's happening in your arteries as well. It gets smaller and the pressure goes up. And the purpose of that would be to get the blood, the nutrients to the bigger muscles faster. Your body is flooded with cholesterol and blood sugar. So if that happens one time and we come down after, or we even go out for a run and we use it all up, or a walk or anything active, then that won't negatively affect our health. But if we have the problem with our modern day is most of our stresses are psychological, so we're not using that energy or fuel that's on board, and it stays on and builds up over time. So lots more on stress in the Stressing Well class, which is also available on YouTube, so feel free to check that out. But I just wanted to make that connection. So just kind of taking a step back, looking at your own life, what's your stress level like? Is there any sort of manageable things you can do to help with your stress? Because that can be a big factor if you know, things like blood sugar are going up and lipids or the fats in the blood. The other thing that tends to happen is that bodies under stress typically will store. So the brain and the body is kind of thinking, I don't know when she's going to, or he's going to have this problem, or she's going to have to get out of here again. So when he or she takes in calories, I should just really hang on to those. That's kind of what the body is thinking. So sometimes we'll have, we'll just notice our weight is creeping up and we haven't really eaten any different. But maybe things like we're not sleeping as good, you know, that kind of shifts our hormones and, might make it a little easier to put on some extra weight that we weren't planning for or anticipating. Okay, so like I said, lots more on stressing well in the Stressing Well class, things that you can do. Feel free to check that out on YouTube or attend one of our virtual classes. So as with everything in the body, there's a reason it's there. It's just about keeping it in balance. So cholesterol is one of those things. It's a waxy substance in the blood. There's the two main types, which we'll talk about in just 1 second, but it does have important functions. It's components of our cell membranes and nerve tissue, and it's a part of certain hormones. So it really does have an important function. It's just when it gets out of balance, it's like everything with our body, right? It's if we can keep everything in balance, it all functions well. And in saying that, I'll say that sometimes people can do all the right things and just the way their genetics are set up, they can still have troubles and issues with things. So no blame or judgment here, just trying to be the healthiest version of ourselves. So this is what your arteries will look like. And again, I always think of a garden hose. And then if everything's free and clear, the water is moving through nicely. But what might happen over time is when there's too much cholesterol in the blood, it builds up somewhere. It might build up in the arteries. And it sort of just creates deposits there. So the space where the blood can move through get smaller. And if it closes off completely, that's when we end up with a heart attack or a stroke. So we just want to be really careful to not have that happen. So just a little joke there about finding some blood in your cholesterol. But sometimes when people come in, they have no idea what the numbers mean or which one was high. So I do like to explain that because it can give us a little bit of clues as to what we should be looking for and paying attention to. So when you hear LDL, it stands for low density lipoprotein. Doesn't matter if you ever remember that. But when you hear L, think lousy. We want to keep this one low. It is carrying mostly fat from the liver to other parts of the body. So we do want to keep this one in check. So certain level is totally normal. But again, balance is what we want. So if you're in the general population, the numbers for the population are 3.37. We want to keep it under that. But if you have risk factors, then we want to keep it under 2. We really want to be careful with you. And if your doctor has different numbers or your nurse in your medical home, that's because they've used a risk scale that's based individually on you. So their numbers are the ones that would be most specific to you. These are just population recommendations, just to give you an idea. So you can ballpark if you do have your numbers, you can see how they match up against these. But if you've talked to somebody in your medical home and you have different numbers, then definitely go with those targets. Okay, and the other one, HDL. So high density lipoprotein, don't need to remember that either, but HDL, H, think healthy. We wanna keep this one high. So it actually is like a car and it drives the LDL out of the body. And it can definitely be increased with exercise, and it is decreased with smoking. So the other thing that increased with exercise, omega-3s and fiber. So we can actually add some things like omega-3s and fiber instead of always thinking about what we have to take out. We can add some things that can help us here. So the target is greater than 1. and the higher the better with HDL. Triglycerides always kind of confuse people a little bit. They're a slightly different molecule. So they're three fatty acids on a glycerol backbone, and it is our storage molecule. So very typically, I'll talk to people a lot about their meal timing, because I do find in the Western world, we tend to have a very small breakfast or skip breakfast, very small lunch or skip lunch. And then we come home and we're hungry and we do those kind of snacky foods while we're making dinner. We might eat dinner and feel snacky all night long. And that kind of thing, that idea of having excess all at once, even if in the whole day your calories weren't high, but because you had them all in sort of between 4 o'clock and 7 o'clock, it's excess at any one time that can sometimes drive up triglycerides. So things like big meals all at once, or having a sweet tooth, or alcohol is sometimes where we'll see triglycerides be higher. Target for triglycerides is having them under 1.7. Yes. Did you know that our livers make most of the cholesterol in our bodies? So our livers take the saturated fat that we take in and turn it into cholesterol. And I think sometimes people get confused with foods or dietary cholesterol, so foods that have cholesterol, and a saturated fat. So I will talk about that again, but I just want to twig that for you one time, so that you're kind of listening for it when I talk about it, because that's probably the most confusing thing I hear people say. So heart healthy eating, the four F's, like I said, fats, fruits and vegetables, fiber and fluids. And the low salt piece, I will talk more during the blood pressure, but really all of us should be shooting to have a little less salt in our diets, unless you've kind of removed the salt shaker and you don't do very much processed foods at all. Most of us can take a peek at reducing our salt level, sodium level. Okay, so I love the healthy plate. I think it works for just about everything. I can't think of a situation where it doesn't work. It, for the most part, it still allows a lot of flexibility and a lot of fun with our food, allowing us the foods we enjoy. So if we just think about taking our plate and splitting it in half and filling up half of it with vegetables and maybe some fruit, and then a quarter of it being the starch and a quarter of it being the meat. And then again, just kind of making note that our plate is not gigantic, but a regular size plate, because that can happen too. And if you know that you're nowhere near this, if actually the meat is taking up half the plate, or the starch, the potatoes are taking up half the plate, we want to just kind of start to two bites less. We call it a just noticeable difference. So two bites less of the potato or the steak, and then two bites more of the vegetables or fruit. There's no denying the research on how good fruits and vegetables are. Although nutrition is a new science, it's only been studied for about the last 100 years. Very much of the evidence we do have is in the field of vegetables and fruit. And I would say it's overwhelmingly compelling that, you know, especially with the veggies, and as long as we don't go too wild with the fruits, that they're good and healthy for us. We do want to kind of emphasize those. And I always like to encourage people to focus on what they want to attract in and not what they shouldn't do. So I want to focus on what I should do and not what I shouldn't do, because it's hard to, when we tell ourselves not to think about something, it's the first thing we're thinking about. So and the hand jive, I prefer the plate method, but some people like to just think about this in different ways. So my fist is fairly small. Some people's fists are quite large. So just take that into account. But yeah, so my fist is probably more like what we want for a serving of fruits or grains or starches. But vegetables, I don't care how big your hands are, you can have whatever you want. And then meat, the size of the palm of your hand, the width of your thumb, or you can think about a size of a deck of cards. And then for the fat piece, we're thinking about a tablespoon, which is the tip of our thumb. So I don't know if that's helpful or not, but it's just another way to look at what our portions should be. No matter what you use to guide your portions, just, you know, if you know there's places where you over portion, probably going to the perfect portion overnight is not going to serve you too well. The brain's going to sense deprivation. So like I said, that just noticeable difference, just two bites less of the things you should have a little less of, and two bites more of the things you want to work in a bit more. Okay, so we're diving into the fats, which is really the the meat, excuse the pun, of the presentation. So I don't like to talk about foods as good and bad, because I think that relationship, that good, bad, dichotomous relationship with food really sets us up for some weird dynamics and also some bad behavior around food. But we do talk about it in cholesterol class with the fats, because I just think it helps to bring things to light what we should emphasize and what we should be trying to not get so much of. So I talk about the fats, the good, the bad, and the ugly. So the good ones are the unsaturated fats, and we'll go into this in a bit more detail. And then the bad ones are the saturated fat, because they raise both the LDL and the HDL. And then the trans fats, which are the ugly ones, because they're mostly man-made. They're not really found anywhere naturally in the diet, except for a little bit in whole milk, which is so minuscule compared to how we've made these and manufactured these fats in the human diet. So the good, the bad, and the ugly. And whereas, like I said, the saturated raises both the HDL and the LDL, the trans fats just raise the LDL. So that's why they're even a little bit worse for our body. Well, quite a bit worse. We know that just trans fats can have a huge impact on our risk for heart disease and stroke, just all on their own. So it is really not important that you know which one is a monounsaturated or which one is a polyunsaturated. It was just a lot to put on one slide. But good fats, we want to emphasize more of, are things like olive oil and canola oil. Canola oil does better at high temperatures, so that's the one I usually recommend for people for in the stove. But if they're making a dressing or something, olive oil can be really good for that. A non-hydrogenated margarine, avocados, nuts such as almonds, pistachios, cashews, pecans, and hazelnuts. And then your polyunsaturated, so these will be your omega-3s. So we're all hearing about how important those are to get in our diet. raising our omega-3s can help bring down our triglycerides. So, all on their own, just a really great way to start to balance things out in the body. And I'll talk about that caution in just one sec. That's at the bottom slide. I made a whole slide for it because it was a bit confusing. Fatty fish to get those omega-3s. So things like salmon and herring and sardines and trout and char and mackerel. And we're aiming for those 2 servings a week. But if you're not eating any fish right now, maybe you shoot for once a month. Maybe you don't really like it that much and just want to try something new. This is a great place to kind of start and look at things. So just try for once a month to start. And then maybe you work up to once a week or twice a month, maybe. Just because the guidelines there, we're just working towards it. It doesn't mean it's all or nothing. This slide always makes me laugh, because I think if you don't like fish, what are the chances you're going to like kelp or seaweed? But there are other fortified foods out there, like fortified eggs, like the omega-3 eggs and the omega-3 margarines, or the margarines with plant sterols. Those are good options to look at. And there are, of course, plant sources of omega-3, so things like ground flax and flax oil, walnuts and walnut oil, chia seeds are a good source of omega-3, and canola oil as well. Okay, so here's the one caution I warned you I was coming back to talk about. So when the omega-6s are in a ratio of about 3 omega-6s to 1 omega-3, then we're good. There's no problem. Even 4, I've read in some papers, 4 omega-6s to 1 omega-3. They are not inflammatory. They're good for the body. No issue. Unfortunately, the typical Canadian diet, I've read different papers that say we're 16 omega-6 to 1 omega-3. And some papers were saying up as high as 21 omega-6 to 1 omega-3. And in this scenario, those fats take different pathways and they can become quite inflammatory. So the fact is, the human body was never meant to process things so in such high amounts like that. So I don't really blame the whole foods. Like, I'm not really worried about safflower or sunflower oil or even sunflower seeds, unless you eat a really lot of them. It's more from things like packaged foods, like salad dressings. So if we can make our dressing at home with some olive oil and some vinegar or some balsamic, that serves us a lot better than some of these processed foods. Okay. So, and then saturated fat. So usually when I think of saturated fat, I think foods of animal origin with a couple of exceptions. So the things that come to mind are the white marbling on a pork chop or steak, that visible white marbling, that's saturated fat. If you're frying up ground beef or bacon, what comes off in the pan, hopefully you're draining it off. That's a saturated fat. High fat dairy. So if you're drinking whole milk or having butter, those all have saturated fat in them. Fried foods. The two exceptions is palm and coconut oil. So palm and coconut oil stay solid at room temperature, and they are highly saturated. And I think coconut oil is just worth talking about because I think it's one of those things that has been really NutriWashed. I have seen coconut oil touted for just about everything. Definitely if you have a recipe that uses a little bit of coconut ghee or coconut oil, I'm not too worried about it, but it is just as saturated as butter. So where things went off the rails with coconut oil is, and it's debatable how much coconut oil actually has of the MCT, so medium chain triglycerides, which are known to be heart healthy. But a lot of the research when they're talking about coconut oil, they're actually taking research that was on MCT oil, so isolated MCT oil. And that's a lot different than what coconut oil actually is. So, yeah, if you have a recipe that you love that uses coconut oil, okay, just like I would say, if you're having a feed of corn on the cob and what you love more than anything is a little bit of butter on there, I would say, yeah, take it easy, but like enjoy your food for sure. We can't stop living. But this is a risk. So we want to really keep that in balance with other things we're doing, right? Okay. And a focus on the good fats. So it's funny, this slide is here. It should actually be one before this, but anyway, you'll excuse the mistake here. But so lean cuts of meats, small amounts of canola oil and olive oil in cooking, trim fat from the meat and watch your portions. And again, if you know you have like a 12 ounce steak, maybe you just cut off two bites there, or a 10 ounce steak or a 6 ounce steak, like wherever you're at, meet yourself there, and just a little bit less. Remove the skin from the poultry. So the fat of poultry products is right under the skin. So if we remove it before cooking, we remove a lot of the fat that way. If you leave it on during cooking, then you are going to retain more of the fat. But sometimes people need a bit of moisture. So avoiding the processed meats like pepperoni and sausages and things like that. And you know, get crazy, try a meatless meal once a month. Like maybe you have something that doesn't have any meat in it and you try things like lentils or beans or, oh my gosh, maybe even tofu. Give it a whirl and just like a gentle curiosity and see, maybe, you know, you try it a few ways, maybe you like something like this and it would change your diet a little bit. Okay, so sorry, that's a little disjointed because I talked about the good and then one of the bad ones. And then I talked about good fats again, and now I'm going to talk about the ugly ones. So trans fats increases, like I said, the bad LDL cholesterol and decreases the good HDL cholesterol. So they're really not good for us. Trans fats are formed through this process called hydrogenation. So when we saw that things like butter weren't so good for us and we saw that things like canola oil were better, we thought, well, what if we can make canola oil into a spreadable product? And we made this through this process of hydrogenation, and it changed the chemical structure of the molecule into a, instead of a cis, it's a trans structure, and our bodies just do not know what to do with them. So unfortunately, it doesn't work well for us. And they still, although the legislation is currently being, we're supposed to be getting rid of trans fats by a certain date, we still will see them in the food supply. So best ways to reduce trans fats is a non-hydrogenated margarine or a margarine produced by a process called esterification. Home baked goods, definitely store-bought goods, tend to have lots of trans fats in them, and look for 0 grams of trans fats on the label. Yeah, and reducing triglycerides, I already kind of mentioned this, but just to come back to it, regular meals at regular times, watch the excess at any one time, and trying to eat more fatty fish. And if you really don't like fatty fish, the research is not as good on the supplements. as it is on the actual foods. We have more research on actually eating fish, but I would say a supplement isn't a bad idea if you're open to considering that. It certainly wouldn't do any harm. Okay, dietary cholesterol. I promised you I'd talk about this, and so now I'm going to. So remember when I said that your liver takes saturated fat and turns it into cholesterol? So you want to think that anything with a liver probably has some cholesterol, because their bodies took saturated fat and made it into cholesterol. But what we want to focus on here is not the cholesterol we take in from the diet, because a lot of things will kind of, a lot of marketing and manufacturing will, like sunflower seeds will say no cholesterol. Well, sunflower seeds don't have a liver, so they never had any cholesterol to begin with, but we want to know how much saturated fat is in that product, because our bodies will take that saturated fat and turn it into cholesterol. So things that have dietary cholesterol are things like eggs and organ meats and full fat dairy products. But when we take those in, we're not as worried, because we usually take those in and about 10% of that will change into our blood cholesterol. So most of it is turned into other things. Like, for example, dietary cholesterol is a precursor to vitamin D. Vitamin D is a hormone that we know is good for us. The egg debate has gone back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. And I would say for the general population, I'm not worried. I don't hear people eating so much eggs. If you do have concerns about your lipid profile, then I would say probably 4 yolks a week is, it's being conservative. And everybody's body is different on the way they process things. So when I'm saying 10%, it could be give or take a little bit. So that would be the recommendation there. So just the key message there is dietary cholesterol is cholesterol in the foods we eat, and our bodies tend to take that cholesterol and turn it into something else. What we want to watch out for are those saturated fats and those trans fats, because our bodies take those in and turn it into our blood cholesterol. I hope that made sense. I get asked that question a lot of times. This is a little jumping around here. Focus on the good fats. So a real easy way to add a bit more good fats in your diet is to add chia or flax or hemp seed to your yogurt or cereal or in baking, to eat lower fat dairy products and select foods with less than 2 grams of saturated fat. So less than 2 grams of saturated fat, 2, and 0 of trans fats if you can, because trans fats just are not good for us. And we will see that in the marketplace soon, that the manufacturers have been asked to get trans fats to 0, and they have a certain amount of time to do it. Fiber is like one of my favorite things to talk about is fruits and vegetables and fiber, because I love to tell people what they can add to their diet and not what they maybe should be not having so much of. So fiber is definitely our friend, and we do not get anywhere near enough fiber in the typical Canadian diet. But it's like a sponge brush, and it's just going through the body, cleaning us out as it goes. And everybody always says, well, I'm regular, I don't need more fiber. But it's not just about regularity, it's that scrub brush effect that it has. It helps the liver and the kidneys function better. It just makes the body work better. It also has a huge impact on our low gut and the bacteria. That's the food for the bacteria in the low gut, which have a huge impact on our health, of which we're just starting to scratch the surface of what we know about it. So we do really want to feed that low gut and those bacteria down there. So lowers your risk of heart disease. Also, it'll help improve your cholesterol levels. I like fiber with a meal because it also, instead of spiking the blood sugars, fiber helps slow the digestion from the stomach. So just a slower curve. So it helps control our blood sugar, helps control our cholesterol levels. It just has a lot of really good effects in the body. So how much fiber do I need? This chart, you can pay attention to it if you want. I usually think between 25 and 35 grams. And if we're doing that, we're doing amazing, because the average Canadian gets about 14. But I often, if people have a little bit of digestive issues, I'll ask them to kind of look at fiber, and especially soluble fiber, and get it up to at least 25 grams before we do any major changes. And sometimes just that little bit of fiber makes a big difference on their symptoms, and we don't have to do too much more dietary manipulation, which is cool. So places to get fiber, of course, our fruits and vegetables are loaded with fiber. Our whole grain products, things like beans, dried peas and lentils, excellent sources of fiber or nuts and seeds or any things that are made from those ingredients. And that's just the same thing with some pictures for you. I really dislike the word detox because our bodies are amazing detoxing machines. Actually, our liver and kidneys are all the detox we need, but we just need to give them good nutrition. So for example, like to detox a cup of coffee, and detox to me just means I'm turning that cup of coffee into something that I can excrete. I need magnesium like 4 times in that pathway. So just that's just looking at magnesium. There's tons of other stuff that we need. So your body needs good nutrition to detox. So when people say they're detoxing and they fast, it just doesn't make sense to me. There's of course fasting for spiritual reasons, which I put in a totally different category. But if you're fasting because you think it'll make your body work better, physiologically speaking, that doesn't make a lot of sense to me. We have to help our body do what it needs to do by feeding it, by nourishing it. So eating those whole grains, we mentioned that. Looking for the word whole grain in the ingredient list. Try new whole grains. So try millet and barley and oats. We've lost all these, our traditional grains, and we just really focus on wheat, but there's so many out there. Quinoa and brown rice. I'm just looking for the whole grains and trying to incorporate more of them. I think we talked about most of these things. So just filling half our plate with fruits and veggies. Every time you're putting a food in your mouth, if you can have a fruit or veggie there, I think that's a great rule of thumb. Instead of drinking fruit or vegetable juice, try eating a fruit or vegetable instead. If you can find a way to use beans, dried peas and lentils, you could stretch your meat. So you could add a bit of lentils to say, maybe you're making hamburgers, you can add a bit of lentils to them. So it's going to stretch your meat. Lentils are really inexpensive. You probably won't notice them. I know I don't notice them very often, especially if I puree them like in sauces, like spaghetti sauce or pizza sauce. If I just throw a half a cup or a cup in my sauce, I don't notice them. So that would be something to try to incorporate and see. They would add more fiber, more nutrition, cheaper. So it's kind of win-win-win. So bring on the fruits and vegetables, because I can't stop talking about fruits and vegetables. I have a fruit and vegetable problem. So just little tips that people have given me over the years. They add sliced fruit to their cereal or to their yogurt, vegetables or greens to their smoothies. I add everything to my smoothie. So if I have a cauliflower that's starting to go that we didn't quite use up, I'll throw that in there. I throw broccoli in, all the greens, anything from my garden, the beet tops, all that go into my smoothies. I don't really notice it, like the berries and the yogurt kind of cover the flavor of those things. So experiment with it and see where you can get a little bit more in. It's hard to get. So a lot of the research is based on 8 servings a day, and that is a trick. I know myself, I have trouble doing it. So any way we can kind of sneak them in, it all adds up. So just adding a salad with different kinds of greens to lunch or supper. When I come home from the grocery store, that's my favorite tip. Chopping up some veggies in trays that I've saved. So some peppers, some carrots, some cucumber, whatever you might like, some little tomatoes, get them all washed up. So if we come home and we're hungry, whatever, something went sideways, or I'm just needing a quick meal, I throw the veggie tray on the table, get a little quick something, and we're good. Oh, and yeah, easy to throw a piece of fruit or something in your purse, an apple, banana, pear, an orange like that, just for a quick snack. Okay, I think I talked about most of these things. I'll just highlight a few. So you can add bran, wheat, germ, flaxseed, chia, or hemp. Psyllium husk is another great one, PSY psyllium, to your cereals in the morning. Just, you know, a psyllium husk, it would be like a teaspoon. And if it's things like flaxseed or wheat germ or chia or hemp, you might add a tablespoon or two. And we talked about the barley's beans to soup. And even if you're having canned soup, that would make it a lot healthier and more fruits and veggies. I think I maybe said that once before. When you add fiber, add it slowly because it is, again, there's lots that happens in digestion. And so it can give you a little bit of digestive upset if you add too much too fast. And we really want to increase fluids because fiber for the bowel is a bit of a double-edged sword. So it will increase the stool bulk. If we don't have enough fluid there, sometimes things can get backed up or constipated. So we don't want that. So as long as you have enough fluid, it also decreases transit time. So it actually moves things through the colon faster. So that's the nice piece of that. Usually it balances things out, but we do have to have enough fluid to make that work. So just a little of an example of how small changes can make a big difference. So this person has Rice Krispies in the morning with some milk and a white toast with butter. And then the lunch is a tuna sandwich with a cup of canned tomato soup. And supper, grilled chicken breast, white rice, romaine lettuce, cucumber, tomato. Everybody can admit this is pretty healthy eating, right? But we want to do a little better when it comes to fiber if we can. And again, we might not do all these things, but even if we picked one or two of these little shifts to make, so changing that Rice Krispie cereal to a corn bran cereal, or maybe we just sprinkle a little psyllium husk on top, or flaxseed, or chia, or hemp. And then we change that white toast to a pear. Huge, look at that, 5 grams, 5.5 grams of fiber in a pear because of that skin of the pear. Change the white bread to whole grain. And instead of having the tomato soup, we added some tomato slices and some raspberries. Again, look at the raspberries, 1/2 cup of raspberries, 4 grams of fiber. And then, so at supper time, some changes there, white rice to brown rice. The lettuce to green peas and the other veggies to broccoli. And we've gone from 10 grams of fiber to almost 30. So huge. We don't want to do this overnight, but if you thought that, oh, you know, that piece about adding the pear in the morning, I could do that. I actually really like pears. So that would be a good change for you. Drinks, I always say you're sweet enough, just choose water or milk because it's very easy to get 500 to 1,000 calories in those drinks and we won't feel satisfied from them. So we're still going to eat the same way typically that we usually would. So I do want to say though, if you have something special that you have, say an eggnog latte or something like that, that you have at Christmas and you have it twice a year, then I don't care. You have it, enjoy it, savor it, don't look at what's in it. But if it is more often than that, if it's an every week or a couple of times a week or an everyday habit, then I think you owe it to yourself to kind of know what's in there. And maybe there's some simple substitutions you can make, you know, low fat dairy, maybe the sweetener instead of sugar, or you can ask for less sugar. They can accommodate lots of different requests, but if it's something you're doing every day or every other day or a couple times a week or even every week, it starts to add up. So it's good to know what it is you're taking in exactly. So be a label reader, ask questions. Okay, healthy drinks. You know, just the basics, using lemon, lime, or other fresh fruit. So cucumbers, have one of those infusers with the strawberries, orange slices, things like that to flavor the water. Have a water bottle with you all the time. Depends on what temperature you like your water. Some people like it cold, so keep a pitcher in the fridge. I tend to like my water at room temperature, so I keep a pitcher on the counter. So it's just whatever appeals to you more. You could add a splash of juice to your plain water, or those little squeezes, those little Mio's or Crystal Lights, give it a little flavor. They're sweetener in them. They're usually sweetened with Ace K or aspartame, but because it's such a small amount, not really worrisome. And if you do choose the sugar sweetened beverages, just go for the small size. They're so big, those juices and things. So split it with somebody or take the smallest size. We just don't need all that sugar that we've been encountering in our world. Okay, what about alcohol? So if you don't drink, it's not time to start. If you don't drink, don't start. But if you do, we just want you to keep it moderate. And I actually feel like the moderate guidelines are pretty flexible. So for women, no more than 10 drinks per week, but you can't save them all up for Friday. So it's no more than 2 drinks a day. And for men, they actually have even more allowance there. They get 15 drinks a week, but no more than 3 a day. So don't save them up. That's really hard on your liver to detox all of that alcohol at one time. So usually 2 a day for women and 3 a day for men. yeah, if you have any questions about alcohol, feel free to talk to them in your medical home, either your doctor or your nurse or your social worker. Smoking, it's a good time to be a quitter. It's definitely the best thing you can do for your heart and your health. There are great resources out there, so I'm not going to spend too much time talking about it. But whether you decide you want to quit or you decide you want to cut down, that's huge, huge for your health. I know it's very hard and difficult, and sometimes people have to quit a half dozen times. But the fact is, we keep trying to quit. So it's really good. So I love this website, www.abquits, Alberta Quits, or the phone number there, 1-866-979-3553. You can sign up for Alberta Quits. They send you emails, helpful tips. Sometimes they have classes, but I haven't seen those recently. So the other thing you can do is talk to the folks in your medical home. So if you doctor from Airdrie out to Didsbury, you have a nurse and a social worker attached, and they would be able to help you with a little bit more smoking cessation, and your doctor too. So physical activity. So ending off with, one of the best things, right? Quitting smoking is one of the best things we can do for our health. Physical activity, just getting our bodies moving. One of the best things we can do for our health, just generally speaking. So the one thing I always encourage people not to do is do something they hate. So I've had people, I'm walking on the treadmill for 15 minutes every day, but I hate it. So I just don't think that we're going to stick with something that we hate. So we really want to look at things that we enjoy, whether it's something silly like closing all the blinds and dancing around our living room, or picking up something that we loved when we were a kid, like going to throw the softball around, or maybe we don't like sports like that. Maybe we like to garden, but as long as we're moving. And no matter what our limitations are, like this lovely lady in her wheelchair, she's using her upper body. We can find a way to be active for the largest part of us. So lots of ways to be active and just keep our bodies moving. So good for us. So fitting activities into our everyday, everybody knows these, like park farther away and take the stairs and all that kind of stuff. That really does add up. I think we are such all or nothing thinkers, especially when it comes to activity, that our kinesiologist has a little suggestion, especially I've used it a lot working from home. And she says 60 and 5. So for every 60 minutes I sit, I need to get up for 5 minutes. I don't even always get to the 5. If I even do 60 and 1, get up and I do a little something, I feel so much better in the day and I feel like my brain is working better. So start with 60 and 1. So even if you're, that's 8 minutes of activity in an 8-hour workday, it's way better than not doing it at all. And it does add up. And she even says when you sit down every time, do a little squat when you sit. So you get your leg muscles moving. We can break our activity into smaller chunks for sure. I know sometimes people get discouraged when the doctor says, no, you have to do 30 minutes every day. Yeah, we want to work up to there. We might even want to get more than that at some point. But to start, if we haven't been active at all and we go for a 5-minute walk around the block and we're doing that consistently every Monday, Wednesday, that's fantastic. That's what we want to do. We want to, and we say, oh, that's no big deal. I can do that. That's what we want. We don't want it to like upset your life and you have to go for an hour a day, because we're not going to stick with that. So just start with one small thing. 5-minute walk after dinner. Maybe you get outside and you're loving it and you stay out for 10 minutes. Fantastic. Just get out the door and start moving. And I always like to tell people, like, even when I'm feeling really, really tired and worn out, I usually just get my shoes on and I get out the door, and then I see. If I go a few minutes and I still feel awful, then I come home and I rest because I'm listening to my body. But most of the time, it's just my brain wanting me to sit on the couch. So once I get my shoes on and I step out the door, I've already done the hard part. And then I start enjoying myself. So, it's be kind to ourselves, but also our bodies were meant to move. We were never meant to sit as much as we are. And it's not good for our hearts. We got to use that fuel that we have on board. So yeah, start with one small change. And I mentioned a lot of these things, walking after eating, use things around your kitchen like soup cans. You can do a little bicep curls with that, just to give you a little bit of weight. Our kinesiologist also talks about just reducing your sedentary time. So if you spend a couple hours watching TV at night. Maybe a strategy for you is, although we don't really have too much with commercials, but maybe that 60 in one or 30 in one. For every 30 minutes of a show I watch, I get up and I move for one. So just thinking about different ways to look at it. But yeah, all the little bits count. So that's the end of our cholesterol presentation. Thank you so much for listening. And then I'll try to get the link to the blood pressure one up and going, because we're going to talk a little bit more about the salt piece, which also links in well with this one. And we all should be trying to reduce our salt. I mentioned our medical home team. So if you doctor from Airdrie out to Didsbury, you've got a nurse and a social worker attached right in your doctor's office, and they are amazing at answering questions. I mentioned our YouTube channel for all our other videos, and especially as it pertains to cholesterol today, we talked about stressing well, but the blood pressure one will also be, they're really, really connected. Yeah, and check out our Facebook page and our website. HPCN.ca is our website, and our Facebook page is Highland Primary Care Network. We're always posting things there that we think might be helpful, or where our classes are and all that navigating kind of stuff for you. So I hope that's helpful. I tried to do it as quick as I can, with as much keeping it interesting as I can. Questions, definitely ask your medical home, and tune into the blood pressure one, which will have more information about salt. Okay, take really good care, and I hope we talk soon. Bye-bye.